All right, good evening.
Hello.
Howdy.
Praise the Lord. Can you hear me? Can you hear me, Carol? Can you hear me? Okay. All right. So I'll be brief tonight. This morning, Facebook kindly reminded me that 3 years ago today, Mike and I became Facebook friends. So we're celebrating our anniversary. Happy anniversary. You know, and that got me thinking about, you know, your brothers and sisters in Christ. And I was looking for a scripture to read tonight regarding that. And when I was searching, I feel led to this particular one. I'm going to read the whole chapter. It's 1 John chapter 3. And it says, "See what kind of love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God. And so we are. The reason why the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now, and what we will be has not yet appeared. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is. And anyone who thus hopes in him purifies himself as he is pure. Everyone who makes a practice of sinning also practices lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he appeared in order to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him keeps on sinning. No one who keeps on sinning has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Whoever practices righteousness is righteous, as he is righteous. Whoever makes a practice of sinning is of the devil, for the devil has been sinning from the beginning. The reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the works of the devil. No one born of God makes a practice of sinning, for God's seed abides in him, and he cannot keep on sinning because he has been born of God. By this, it is evident who are the children of God and who are the children of the devil. Whoever does not practice righteousness is not of God, nor is the one who does not love his brother. For this is the message that you have heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. We should not be like Cain, who was of the evil one and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his own deeds were evil and his brother's righteous. Do not be surprised, brothers, that the world hates you. We know that we have passed out of death into life because we love the brothers. Whoever does not love abides in death. Everyone who hates his brother is a murderer, and you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. By this we know love, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brothers. But if anyone has the world's goods and sees his brother in need, yet closes his heart against him, how does God's love abide in him? Little children, let us not love in word or talk, but in deed and in truth. By these we shall know that we are of the truth and reassure our hearts before him. For whenever our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart, and he knows everything. Beloved, if our heart does not condemn us, we have confidence before God, and whatever we ask, we receive from him, because we keep his commandments and do what pleases him. And this is his commandment, that we believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as he commanded us. Whoever keeps his commandments abides in God, and God in him. And by this we know that he abides in us by the Spirit whom he has given us. One of the things about that I like about this body is that we live these things. We truly love one another. And then when one of us is in need, we all come for that person together. And we saw an example of that on Sunday and last Wednesday when our brother Robert was in need and we did something good for him because the Lord asked us to love each other.
Right.
And I know that if I'm in need of something, whether it's prayer or I have worldly need, whether it's financial or of any other kind, I know that you guys are gonna come to my aid if I humble myself and ask, and you can count on the same thing for me. And the reason why we do this is because we know him, and we know who he is, and we know, and we have experienced the way that he takes care of us. And as a result of knowing God's love, we cannot help it but to share that towards someone else. And one of the things that the Bible says is that not only we should love our brothers, but we should also pray for our enemies. And that is really hard to do, because you can get annoyed, and I'm guilty of this, you can get annoyed with someone and then you can just brush off that person and not do what you're supposed to do. But we have a Holy Spirit that reminds us of what we have to do. And that's a good thing, because God is always there. God is always there reminding us of what we're supposed to do based on his word. So I encourage you to continue to love your brother and pray for your enemies and for your friends too. And know that you can count on me or anyone else from this body if you have a need. And I know that I can count on you the same way.
Amen.
So. Any prayer requests? Okay, sorry.
I have a hearing aid yet, so.
I was trying to project. Any prayer requests or testimonies tonight? Mike.
I lift up Tammy and Suzanne, Timothy, and their family situation. Cindy had trouble breathing today, the humidity in the air and stuff like that going on. James is AWOL. just some needs going on, and just pray for the hand of the Lord to be upon them, and get the finished work going, and for this Ustream to start broadcasting.
Amen. Anyone else? Yes, brother.
God is bringing restoration to me.
Hallelujah. Thank the Lord.
And it's just like Pastor Nathan told me only 3 weeks ago, I don't know, a while back. I've been waiting for God just to kind of zap me from the outside, just kind of come on me and just change me. And he said it would come from within.
God's really
up within. So as I've been getting into the word Ephesians and doing some study by a teacher, and her name's Billy Grimm, talking about the authority of the believer. Lord has shown me that my authority has been stolen from me for the last 9 years. And but I'm beginning to get more revelation, knowledge, and wisdom and understanding of who he is. And the enemy's right there to just really try to take back what I'm getting. So I just covet your prayers, because sometimes I just, it's like, Lord, I can't take much more of this. I mean, why can't I get this breakthrough? I see here in the word that we're raised with Christ, for the body seated in heavenly places with him.
Yeah.
He's the head, we're the body. And so when we're praying from a position, also the word is not just his sons, but kings.
That's
and
right.
We're seated there with him, looking down into the second realm where the demonic realm works, and then the earth. So we're looking down at the enemy and how we have power, authority, and dominion over him. But it's up to us to exercise that authority. The Lord won't do it for us.
That's right.
And here I've been waiting for the Lord to do this because I didn't feel confident myself. But as I'm seeing now, like Christ in me.
Yes.
And anyhow, just praise God for that.
Mm-hmm.
Word from Nathan and how that's coming to pass. And it's been really hard for me to get here. I mean, it's hard for me to even get up in the morning period during the week. I'm on SSI, so I don't have a job, and I get attacked with self-worth. What are you going to do with your day? Well, the other day I drove past a blind man sitting on a bench waiting for a bus with his cane. And I felt this small unction come over me. Pray over that man.
Come on.
Well, it was kind of hard to get to him, and I made an excuse. I said, well, Lord, if he's there when I get to Walgreens, if he's there on the way back, I'll pray for him. When I come back, right, he was gone. And I really felt bad. I had to ask the Lord to forgive me because I let fear or something come in. But I thank God at least he gave me an unction to go for a man with blind eyes.
Yeah.
And he told me it's no different than a man with a bad knee.
Yeah. Yep.
To him, it's all the same.
Yeah.
So just, anyhow, I just feel that unction starting again, and I just continue to bless this fellowship, and
amen.
And I've been pleading the blood and claiming the blood. And
mm-hmm. Amen.
Just
yeah.
Thank you. So I just covet your prayers for me if you think about me. That's my
amen.
Name. So.
Amen. All the time. Thank the Lord.
Bless you.
God.
So when you were speaking now, it reminded me of a teaching series that I have, that I've listened to several times. And the title of the series is called Framing Your World with Your Words. In the second part of the series, he focused on this scripture, and I'm going to read it to you. It's Matthew chapter 11, and it starts in verse 7. As they went away, Jesus began to speak to the crowds concerning John. What did you go out into the wilderness to see? A reed shaken by the wind? What then did you go out to see? A man dressed in soft clothing? Behold, those who wear soft clothing are in king's houses. What then did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I tell you, and more than a prophet. Behold, this is he of whom it is written, this is he of whom it is written, behold, I send my messenger before your face who will prepare your way before you. The Bible said the prophets, they spoke the word that God gave them, declaring what God was going to do. But the Bible also says in 1 Corinthians 14 that we should desire the gifts of the Spirit, but also that we prophesy. So we're also prophets. And then in verse 11 here, it says, truly I say to you, among those born of women, there has arisen no one greater than John the Baptist. Yet the one who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. What was John the Baptist? A prophet. Are we prophets? Yes. So now you're going through a situation and you feel like your authority has been taken from you, then this is what it says in verse 12. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven has suffered violence, and the violent take it by force. What force are you going to use? The word that you're going to speak onto your situation.
Yeah.
And the circumstances are going to change.
Hallelujah.
Just watch it happen.
Yeah, I receive that. I receive that.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yes, Mike.
I forgot. I looked up my arm. He's doing better. Just done a little bit tired today. A little bit of pain, but we're believing in the total healing. And our prayer on the internet's already answered. Our broadcast is rolling.
Amen. Alvin.
I had surgery day before yesterday on a cataract, and everything is going fine, and I can see better, and it you know, just praise the Lord for His wonderful works, and you know, the His hand over the surgeon and the process. And just thank the Lord.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Yes, praise God.
Anyone else? Okay, let's stand. And let's come to the Lord tonight. Father, we thank you for bringing us here in your presence. We thank you, Lord, for the word that you give us, a word that we can speak to every circumstance of our lives, Lord, and we know that we can change that situation by speaking your word and agreeing with what you have promised. Father, we declare that we have the authority to stand and declare your word to the enemy who has been defeated, Lord. We know that the enemy tries to deceive us and take the joy away from us. We know, Father, that all joy comes from you. And your joy, Father, as you have said in your word, is our strength. We thank you, Father, because you have chosen us to go out and carry out this task you have given us, speaking your word and sharing who you are with others, Lord, so that they can come to you. We thank you, Father, for giving us the boldness to stand on the gap for those that are in need, to be able to pray for them, for others, for not only our brothers and sisters, but also for our enemies, Father, that they may come to see you, to know who you are. We know, Lord, that when we renew our minds, we understand your word there. The revelation that we receive from your Holy Spirit, Father, becomes embedded in the tablet of our hearts. Thank you, Father, for giving us that understanding and revealing to our us who you are. Right now, Father, there are some that are suffering. I declare, Lord, that your Holy Spirit, the Comforter, will show them, Lord, who you are, will bring them the peace and comfort that they are so desperately seeking and wanting, Father. We know, Lord, that you are always with us, Father. You're always speaking to us, and you never leave our side. You reveal yourself to us in ways that are unique, but also in ways that we can share with each other, Father. There is the revelation, Lord, that we receive from your Holy Spirit that gives us confidence, Lord, to speak about who you are and speak your word into any situation in our lives and speak into the lives of others. We thank you, Lord, for the way that you speak to us, whether it's directed to us or to others. Because we come together in your name, Lord, for you to manifest and reveal yourself in the way that you want to be revealed. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for giving us this opportunity to share who you are and to continue to know more of who you are. Thank you, Lord, for the sacrifice of the cross, bringing us together, reconciling us to you, calling us your children. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name. All right. Announcements. Please turn your phone off or put it on vibrate mode. August 12th, a week from this Friday, we're having our Eastern Gate House of Prayer. For those that have been here before, you know the things that happen. For those that haven't, if you get the opportunity to do so, once you experience it for the first time, you're going to be hooked. So I encourage you to come and just watch what happens. All right, well, let's speak the word tonight. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you?
Thank you, Lord.
I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus,
I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick and they do recover.
Hallelujah. Thank the Lord Jesus. Thank the Lord.
Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every germ and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God.
Hallelujah.
The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of His servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Will you take the offering, brother? Will you take the offering, please?
Loved us enough, Lord, to redeem us from the curse of the law, from the curse from Adam. And you sent your second Adam, your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you, Lord, that our names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life.
Hallelujah.
And our sins are washed by the blood of the Lamb.
Yes.
We just come and thank you tonight, Lord, for sonship. We thank you for bringing us into your family, God. God, we just pray, let your kingdom come, let your will be done. On earth, in us, as it is in heaven.
Yes.
Let us be your hands, your feet. Let us be your mouthpiece. Wherever we go every day, Lord, God, help us to be led by your Spirit in everything we do, all for your glory and your kingdom. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Thanks, brother.
Yeah. Lord, everybody. Give the Lord a big hand tonight.
Thanks, everybody, for sharing your prayer requests and testimonies. Appreciate it. We take it very seriously, and we're privileged and happy to be able to come before the Lord with you with those requests. And we know that God is not only willing but able, praise the Lord. And we know that whatever we ask according to His will, that we already have it. Amen. And so we just say thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Thank you for healing. Thank you for delivering. Thank you for blessing. Thank you for restoring lives. And thank you for your peace that passes all understanding. Praise God. All right. Praise God. So we're going to get right into the Word tonight. We'll start with John 3:16, Roberto. It's a scripture many of you probably haven't heard. Good one. Praise God. How many of you have heard people say, and maybe even yourself at some point, but have you know, we always hear these are acts of God, you know, like there's a hurricane someplace, there's a tornado, there's you know, those kind of things with people associate with God's wrath, or that God is judging, or that God is trying to fix something that we've screwed up. And I know 9/11, people were just going crazy about God was judging America, and you know, all these kinds of things. I remember back in the 80s when we were in Texas, and the first Gulf War, and there was a huge influx of people to the church. I mean, everybody was coming to pray, and they thought it was, you know, going to be the end of the world, and I don't know what they thought for sure, but that lasted about as long as the war, I think, about 30 days or something. I mean, it was crazy. And then the same ones that had all been there and were sure. I mean, it was kind of like our own congressmen and senators out there on the steps of the Capitol praying. It was like a few years later, they were banning the, you know, the chaplain of the Senate to even use the name of Jesus. I mean, it's just insane. Right. But I'm just saying, people have these ideas of God that He's just out here, you know, wait for an opportunity to crack down on somebody, to get even with, you know, specific countries. How many, you know, I mean, the whole earth is under the grace of God. This is the dispensation, not just for America, not just for Christians, but the entire earth.
Right.
We're in that dispensation where God is dealing with us, amen, by grace. So, I guess I got a question here. Let's just read this. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever should believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. That ought to answer pretty much everybody's questions about what God feels about humanity, right? American or any other, praise the Lord. But I guess here's what happens, and I mean, I've had this conversation with a lot of different people. God watched His own Son die, this horrific, torturous death, and He didn't stop it. He just let it happen. Amen? So why wouldn't He treat me, His Son by faith, the same way? Now, I've talked to people, not people that are here, that happen to be here right now, but people even involved with this church who have questions whether God is trying to adjust them somehow, or fix them, or correct them, or something. Amen. And so they use these kind of analogies in their mind that, well, I mean, look what happened with Jesus. And so why wouldn't He allow me to go through horrible things the same way? Well, first of all, I think we need to remember that Jesus is God. Revelation to some of you, but He is God in the flesh.
Amen. And God gave up his own life, his human life, amen, through Jesus Christ, the Son. So he did it so that we could reign with him, so that we could have dominion, so that we could get back our authority that Doug was talking about, the believer's authority. Now, let's just look at Romans chapter 5, verse 17. Praise the Lord, for if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. So we're reigning and ruling. I think Doug said as well that, you know, we're seated with him in heavenly places. Where are we seated? At the right hand of God. And where is that, pray tell? I mean, how far do you have to go to get there? I mean, he's everywhere, right? It's a position of power and authority. And we're seated there with him in Christ. So we have that. Praise the Lord. And if you get to heaven, if you were to go to heaven today, the God you're going to see is Jesus. God is invisible. Amen. The only visible reality of God in terms of a being is the person of Jesus Christ. So look at this in Revelation chapter 13 and verse 8. All that dwell upon the earth shall worship him whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Everybody's going to worship him. Every knee will bow, every tongue will confess.
That's right.
Amen. Everybody's going to acknowledge that he is Lord.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
And he is, and the reason for that is because he is the Lamb, the substitute sacrifice for the sins of God's children.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Why would God ever want us to experience the very thing that he died to deliver us from?
Right.
I mean, I think most people, I think it's, at least in my mind, most people want to believe that God is good. But they've got a problem trying to harmonize God's goodness with all the evil that's in the world.
Mm-hmm.
And trying to make sense out of all of that.
Right.
Some people say, well, isn't God able to stop the evil in this world? Kind of Christians and, I mean, people in general are more comfortable with sacrificing some of God's goodness rather than altering his power. Or they'd rather believe in a God that's all-powerful than a God who is all-good. Now, if you think about that, it's pretty selfish, really, because it's just about what we're going to get. Amen. What he's going to do for us. Praise the Lord. This reasoning, like, either God has the power to do something about evil, but he chooses not to do something about it, but he chooses to allow it for reasons that we don't understand. Or he has no power to stop evil, which makes him no good at all.
Mm-hmm.
If he can, and he won't, that's not good. If he can't, so he won't, that's not good either. So is he willing to prevent evil, but not able? Then is he impotent? The omnipotent one? Is he able but not willing? Then he's malevolent. Is he both able and willing? Yes. In many minds, God is good or God is able are the options. Scripture holds the truth about God, which sacrifices neither his goodness nor his power. For some reason, divine kindness is easy to accept about Jesus, but not about God. Did we have a... Never mind. They could believe that God is one or the other. Believe that he can, but he just doesn't. Alvin, would you mind stepping to the rear if you're going to do that? Thank you.
I'm just getting ready to do that.
Appreciate it. I'm confused enough on my own. Praise the Lord. Instead of God being three in one, we've made him to be someone with a huge personality disorder. Unpredictable. Not quite right in the brain. I think sometimes we forget that each person of the Godhead is one and the same, coexisting in equality. This is not a message on the Trinity or oneness or any of that kind of stuff. Don't misunderstand what I'm saying. I'm just saying. Sometimes I was talking to somebody the other day about the Holy Spirit, or actually should be Holy Spirit, because Holy Spirit is a person. It's the person of God in the Spirit.
Amen.
And so we don't say the Carol. We say Carol, right? Mm-hmm. So Holy Spirit is a person.
Amen.
But he has the same attributes as the Godhead. The Godhead is three in one. The Godhead is one and the same, coexisting equally. Look at Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 3. If you want to know what God is like, look at Jesus, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, he sat down at the right hand of majesty on high. What we were just talking about in the preliminaries, right? So, if you want to know anything about God, if you want to know something about the Holy Spirit, look at Jesus, and you'll get your answer. Mm-hmm. The Holy Spirit isn't something distinct and separate from Jesus.
Come on.
He is the Spirit of Christ. It's Christ in you, the hope of glory. What you have in you is the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And that is the Spirit of Christ, which leads us and guides us, which is also the Spirit of God. Jesus was filled with the fullness of the Godhead.
Yes.
So he was doing what he saw his Father do. He had to go away to send back the Spirit. It was his Spirit that was coming back to us. Amen. So it's not a conflict. And it isn't like, you know, God the Father is this kind of angry, you know, because he's older, has an attitude, and Jesus being younger is a little more, you know, understanding of our humanity or something. It's not that at all.
Correct.
What we see in Jesus is exactly what the Father is.
Amen.
When the Holy Spirit is dealing with you, he deals with you the same way Jesus has dealt with people within the Scripture. That's why the Bible says that whenever we give prophetic words, whenever we're operating in the gifts of the Spirit, it is for what? To edify, to lift up, to encourage, to be a blessing. When somebody comes along with some, you know, horrible, ugly-sounding word of prophecy, well, they're 2,000 years late. Those kinds of things happened under the Old Covenant when there was a law to deal with and where judgment was coming on a continuous basis for people who were not offering sacrifices or whose sacrifices were not valid.
Amen.
But we have the one and only perfect sacrifice. It's already been made on our account. So we have access and acceptance from God. Amen? So that the disconnect, I guess, between what we're talking about here, this either or thinking, is really about Old Covenant and New Covenant.
Mm-hmm.
It's not about God the Father and Jesus being different. It's about the covenants being different. Because the covenants are different, we think God the Father is different than Jesus or God the Son, when in fact they're one and the same. All right, look at Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 1. Praise the Lord. Everybody having a good time?
Come on now.
You look like it. Yes. Hallelujah. For the law, having a shadow of good things to come and not the very image of the things, can never with those sacrifices which they offered year by year continually make the comers thereunto perfect. So the law, having a shadow of good things to come, right? If you only look at the shadow of God, the shadow of God that is revealed in the Old Testament, you're not going to know his complete features. This is kind of what Moses was up against when he said, show me your face. Because all he could see, all he knew of God was a shadow. He couldn't see the distinction or the definition, the defining of God. He could only see the shadow or the reflection, you might say, of God. Have you ever, if you had two brothers standing side by side, you can't see them. All you can see is their shadow on the wall. One's older, one's younger. Mm-hmm. Depending on where the sun is, you couldn't distinguish one from the other because you can't see any distinction. You can't see any features that would define them clearly enough so you would know one or the other because all you're seeing is a shadow. Mm-hmm. That's what happened under the Old Covenant. You didn't see God. God was not visible. There were different manifestations, but you couldn't see a clear vision of God, a distinct vision or defining vision of God. So people get confused about it, but the truth is, in the New Covenant, we have God no longer a shadow, but a definite person. So you get to see exactly what God is. The only way to discover the true heart of God is by looking at the person of Jesus Christ. Now that's important because we're not becoming God. We're being transformed into the image of Jesus Christ. We are God's, little g, because we are children of God. But we're not God and we're never going to be God.
Right.
But we are being conformed and transformed to the image of Jesus Christ, which is God in the flesh, which is man filled with God. That's what we are right now. That's what every one of us that are born again, that's everybody in this room, already has this fullness of God dwelling in them. Yes. But we go through life like a shadow. Yeah. We're not really reflecting an image of God that's true to God. It's more like the shadow than the reality. And that's because our conforming and our transforming is veiled by this flesh.
Come on.
In fact, this flesh, ourselves, is really the veil.
Mm-hmm.
The veil that keeps not only us, but others from seeing Jesus, God. Let's look at Jonah chapter 1, verses 2 and 3. And this kind of goes to what Roberto was saying in the opening remarks. God speaks to Jonah and he tells him to go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it, for their wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah rose up to flee unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord and went down to Joppa. And he found a ship going to Tarshish, so he paid the fare thereof and went down into it to go with them unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. So God said, here's what I want to do, and I need somebody to do it. And Jonah says, find somebody else. I'm out. I'm out of this. I don't want to go because I don't like the Tarshishians, whatever they were. He didn't like them. He didn't want anything to do with them. He didn't want to go there. So look at chapter 4, verses 2 and 3. And he prayed unto the Lord, and he said, I pray thee, Lord, was not this my saying when I was yet in my own country or in my country? Therefore I fled before unto Tarshish, for I knew that thou art a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger, and of great kindness, and repentest thee of the evil. Therefore now, O Lord, take, I beseech thee, my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. Jonah is offended by God's goodness.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Jonah would rather die than see horrible people of Nineveh receive God's grace. Praise the Lord. Now that's hard to take, but at the same time, I hear people say similar things. Not in this church, but I'm just saying, people that are believers, they want some people destroyed. They don't want them saved. They don't want to be with them in heaven. They want God to deal with them differently than he deals with us. Amen? Jonah is not alone when it comes to choosing zeal or love. Look at, let's go to Jeremiah chapter 15, verses 15 to 21. O Lord, thou knowest, remember me and visit me and revenge me of my persecutors. Take me not away in thy long suffering. Know that for thy sake I have suffered rebuke. Thy words were found and I did eat them, and thy word was unto me the joy and rejoicing of my heart. For I am called by thy name, O Lord God of hosts. I sat not in the assembly of the mockers nor rejoiced. I sat alone because of thy hand, for thou hast filled me with indignation. Why is my pain perpetual and my wound incurable, which refuseth to be healed? Wilt thou be altogether unto me as a liar and as waters that fail? Now, this is the guy that's upset with God. I mean, he's saying, look, I've worked really hard to be accepted by you, and you're not doing me right. You've lied to me. You're deceiving me, right? Therefore, thus saith the Lord. God's got an answer. He's not shaken by this, and his ego isn't disturbed. And he says, if thou return, then will I bring thee again, and thou shalt stand before me. Now, let me read this from the New, I think this is New International. Yes, New International Version. Here's Jeremiah. You understand, O Lord, remember me and care for me. Avenge me of my persecutors. You are long-suffering. Do not take me away. Think of how I suffer reproach for your sake. When your words came, I ate them. They were my joy and my heart's delight, for I bear your name, O Lord God Almighty. I never sat in the company of revelers, never made merry with them. I sat alone because your hand was on me, and you had filled me with indignation. Why is my pain unending and my wound grievous and incurable? Will you be to me like a deceptive brook, like a spring that fails? Therefore, this is what the Lord says. If you repent, if you change your mind about me, about God, that's what he's saying. I will restore you that you may serve me. If you utter worthy, not worthless words, you will be my spokesman. Let this people turn to you, but you must not turn to them. I will make you a wall to this people, a fortified wall of bronze, and they will fight against you, but will not overcome you, for I am with you to rescue and to save you, declares the Lord. I will save you from the hands of the wicked and redeem you from the grasp of the cruel. Mm. So Jeremiah's problem is he's got this perception of God that's not true. And God says, you need to repent. In other words, you need to change your mind about me, about God, and recognize that I'm good, that I'm not the cause of your problem. I'm not the one that's bringing the pain and the suffering. I'm the God that heals and delivers.
Yes.
And I think you could say this to about a large percentage of the Christian church. We need to repent of the way we think about God.
Come on.
Because unless we do, we can't present God to anybody else in any legitimate way or any way that's going to have any kind of transforming effect on them.
That's right.
Praise God. So our responsibility is to receive the love of God. This is where the, you know, we talk about my cup runneth over, and, you know, we get into this stuff where it's all about, you know, I got more money than I can spend, and I'm going to get, you know, so it's just overflowing so I can give some away and all that. I'm not saying God doesn't provide our needs according to his riches and glory. I'm just saying our focus is more about that than it is about the transformation that God's trying to create or develop within us. If we don't know him, how are we going to be transformed into his image?
Exactly.
How can we be conformed to the image of Christ if we don't really have an understanding of who this Christ is?
Yes.
Amen. How can the Holy Spirit talk to you if you don't speak his language? Amen. If he's saying, do this, be this, and we're going, I don't recognize that, it doesn't sound right, it doesn't look right to me, it's because we've got this distorted image, and therefore we're not able to carry out the responsibilities that we have as the body of Christ.
Right.
Unless we get a clear picture, a clear image of God and his goodness and his grace and his mercy in the person of Jesus Christ, there's no way we can ever be conformed to that image.
Come on.
You can't be conformed to something you don't know.
Yeah.
That you have no understanding of. Praise the Lord. Look at this in Luke chapter 13, verses 10 through 17. Luke 13, 10 through 17. Now this is the people who had the greatest knowledge of God that anybody on the planet had. They were given, you know, the codex, the Bible, the scrolls, the scriptures. They had it before it became a codex, before it became, you know, a book. It was scrolls. They had all this information, but they had distorted how to present that reality to anybody else because they didn't understand it themselves. He was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath. Behold, there was a woman which had a spirit of infirmity 18 years and was bowed together and could in no wise lift up herself. And when Jesus saw her, he called her to him and said unto her, woman, thou art loosed from thine infirmity. And he laid his hands on her, and immediately she was made straight and glorified God. And the rulers of the synagogue, which are the religious leaders of the day, answered with indignation, because that Jesus had healed on the Sabbath day, that this God in the flesh performed a healing on their religious day, right? And said unto the people, there are 6 days in which men ought to work, and then therefore come and be healed, and not on the Sabbath day. The Lord then answered him and said, thou hypocrite, doth not each one of you on the Sabbath loose his ox or ass from the stall and lead them away to watering? And ought not this woman, being a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan hath bound low these 18 years, be loosed from this bond on the Sabbath day? And when he had said these things, all his adversaries were ashamed, and all the people rejoiced for all the glorious things that were done by him. The religion of that day sees God do something good, and they're angry.
Mm-hmm.
They're mad. Now, there's no way, if we maintain that kind of relationship with God or understanding of God, that we're ever going to be a representation of God. You can't do it. They couldn't do it. You could become a Jew. It was very difficult because they really weren't looking for converts.
Right.
They were looking to huddle in and, you know, us four no more and just, you know, keep our thing going here.
Yep.
That's why you had the outer court, you know, the court of the Gentiles and so on and so forth. They couldn't actually come close, amen, into the worship itself. So, This is God trying to express something that they had been missing for thousands of years. The true nature of God. The true purpose of God, which was to heal, to deliver, to love, to accept. Amen?
Amen.
Their zeal for the law completely overshadowed their willingness to see people set free. And it resulted in an inability to embrace the gifts and the blessings of God. And I would say that is still true today in many cases.
Mm-hmm.
lot of the reasons we don't see the miraculous to the degree that we should, to the degree that the scripture declares it, is because we are trying to present a God who only connects with the way I think.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm trying to make this God in my own image to do what I think he ought to do. And it's hypocritical. And unsaved people see it and figure that either there is no God, we're just making him up, or there, if there is one, he's indifferent to their situation and their circumstances anyway. Sometimes, you know, in the journey of discovering God, people become like Jonah, become like Jeremiah, offended by God's goodness. But God's love has no rules, has no limitations. Isaiah 55, I'm going to read this, that whole chapter. It's not that long, and I read fast. Isaiah 55. Now, I want you to see this, because some people who, they have issues right now. They have either physical issues, they have financial issues, they have other things. And they think they need to do something else in order for God to then heal them. Or if I do more good stuff, then God will prosper me. I'm not saying we shouldn't try to be better people, that we shouldn't be moral people, that we shouldn't be godly people. I'm just saying that is not what gets you what it is you need. It comes as a gift from God because of his goodness. Oh, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters, and he that hath no money, come ye buy and eat. Yea, come buy wine and milk without money and without price. Wherefore do ye spend money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which satisfieth not? Hearken diligently unto me, and eat ye that which is good, and let your soul delight itself in fatness. Incline your ear and come unto me. Hear, and your soul shall live. And I will make an everlasting covenant with you, even the sure mercies of David. Behold, I have given him for a witness to the people, a leader and a commander to the people. Behold, thou shalt call a nation that thou knowest not, and nations that knew not thee shall run unto thee because of the Lord thy God and for the Holy One of Israel, for he hath glorified thee. Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain cometh down, and the snow from heaven, and returneth not thither, but watereth the earth, and maketh it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower, and bread to the eater. That's enough. Praise the Lord. So, higher ways. Think about it. Higher ways and higher thoughts. You know, I'm on the phone quite a bit with people, and that's one of the reasons that I'm talking about this tonight, because there's been a couple of these situations over the last week since I've been back. And I'm saying that we need to realize God has higher ways and higher thoughts. God is imploring us to come and be refreshed, regardless of our ability to pay for it.
Yes.
To earn it. God promises that even the wicked and evil people can turn to the Lord.
Yes.
And find mercy.
Yes.
And pardon.
Yes.
Back to verse 8 and 9, if you will. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Now, what I want you to notice here in the previous scriptures that we read, and I hope you were paying attention, because there's no mention of hardship There's no talk about tragedy. There's no discussion about car accidents, cancers, heart attacks, diabetes. Nothing. God's higher ways are his love. God simply offers his grace to those who don't deserve it.
Come on.
He doesn't put them in a horrible car accident.
Right.
He doesn't give them cancer. He doesn't give them heart attacks.
Come on.
He doesn't do that. That's not God. God is love. His ways are higher. His love is higher than our love. His mercy is higher.
Yes.
Higher than our form of mercy.
Yes.
We sell our goods for a price. And God gives without cost.
Yes.
Everything.
Yes.
We fail at keeping commitments. But God is faithful to his covenants. We judge and we condemn.
Mm-hmm.
But God freely pardons.
Yes.
Those who put faith in him.
Amen.
Don't let the devil or anyone else deceive you into believing that whatever crap you're going through in life is coming from God.
Right.
Because it's not.
Right.
Our love is limited, but God's love knows no limits. And his goodness fills the heavens. God's ways are higher than our ways. Amen?
Amen.
John 10:10. The devil comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But Jesus said, I've come to give life, and that more abundantly.
Amen. Yes.
That's about as definitive as you can get. If you want to see what the devil is and what God is, there it is right before you.
Mm-hmm.
God comes to give us life, not just eking out life, but a life that is abundant, a life that is full, a life that is satisfying, a life that is fulfilling. Amen?
Amen.
And the devil comes to steal that life,
mm-hmm.
to destroy that life, to kill it. The question remains, do we really believe God? Do we believe that he came to give us life? God is either completely good or something altogether inferior. There are people like the couple that you mentioned that have lost a child, thinking that God may have taken them for a purpose, for some reason, or in some cases even as punishment for something that they may have done. I mean, it's insane, but people believe this stuff. They're looking for answers.
Right.
Why would God, I mean, you even go to funerals and, you know, a child, I've been in them, where a child dies. And the preacher's up there saying, God needed an angel. He needed another angel in heaven. He took your child because he wanted it. And he can take it. I mean, there's some of the dumbest things you could imagine, but it's because we have misunderstood the true nature of God. How are we going to represent him? How can we really be conformed to an image if we don't know the image?
Right.
How can we present God in a way that's truthful and that is attractive? By giving him the truth.
Yes.
In Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Bible theology, I'll just give it to you right now. It's very simple, and I'll close with this. This is the best theology you can have, and the simplest. God is good,
mm-hmm.
and the devil is bad.
That's right. Amen.
If you've got bad stuff going on, it's not God.
Right.
It's the enemy.
Mm-hmm.
God will take even what the enemy meant for evil and turn it to good.
That's right.
Praise the Lord. He'll take our foolish mistakes and make us look like we're geniuses.
Come on.
He gives us the Holy Spirit to lead us and to guide us into all truth.
Yes, Lord.
Number one truth, God is good.
Yes.
Number two, the devil is bad.
That's right.
God is greater. This is a created being we're talking about, Satan. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
He wants to be like God. But he's a complete and a total distortion.
Right.
Praise God.
Amen.
God wants to give us life. And the devil wants to take it.
That's right.
Guess who wins?
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
God wins.
Amen.
Amen. And everyone with him wins. We are more than conquerors through Jesus Christ who gave himself for us.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
We need to, I mean, that's why I focus a lot on grace. And it's because until we get a true image of God, we're not going to fulfill our purpose. Our purpose is not to come to church on Sunday and Wednesday, although we should, because we need the fellowship. We need to hear from one another. We need the entire body for us to function the way we should. But our purpose is to be a revelation of God.
Yes.
In this earth.
Yes, Lord.
Jesus was the perfect revelation, and we are to be conformed to his image. Why? So that God can be real to people. So that they can see him in action.
Amen.
That's our responsibility.
Yes.
Now, we're imperfect, but that's why we have the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
And that's why we have the grace of God.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen?
Amen.
I appreciate what you said, Doug, because it's happened to all of us. We felt the unction to do a certain thing, but we haven't done it because it was inconvenient. We weren't sure. Is this God? Is this me? Is it, you know, what? Sympathy, whatever. I'm just saying, if it doesn't conflict with this word, just believe it's the Lord.
Come on.
Why wouldn't you?
Right.
Amen?
Amen.
I said it the other day, and it's true. God's voice sounds just like mine sometimes. Sometimes it sounds like my wife's. I don't like it when it sounds like my wife's. God, I like it better when it sounds like me. But it sounds like his voice changes, but he never changes. Amen? And if it doesn't conflict with his word, just, it's God. If it's a good thing, it's God. And I'm not trying to beat you up, Doug, because like I said, I've had the same experience where I wanted, you know, I felt like I should have done this, and I did it for whatever reason, you know. And it's awkward sometimes. But listen, if we could ever learn that God wants to use us.
Yes.
Us as we are.
Yes.
Your personality. My personality. Or lack thereof. Without coffee, I have no personality. But two cups of coffee and I'm good to go. But I'm just saying that we are unique for a reason. We can be who we are and have an impact on people that only you or I, given the specific situation, can have an impact on.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why God wants us to be who we are. He created us uniquely. He created us individuals. And when we talk about being conformed to the image of Christ, it's not like we're perfect. It's just that we listen to what the Holy Spirit is saying and do it.
Yes.
We just respond.
Yep.
And I'm telling you, on any given day, you'll have at least an opportunity to do that. Any day, every day, I promise you, there'll be an opportunity to be led by the Spirit to make an impact on somebody else's life. And the way we do that, in more ways than anything else, I don't know, we may give somebody a few bucks, we might buy them a lunch, we might, you know, help them out with something, we may pray for them, we may try to encourage them. But most importantly, is that we give them a revelation of God that is valid, that's true, that's real, that is accurate to his word. And in order to do that, we got to know him. We got to know that he's a God of love.
Mm-hmm.
And just because somebody turns me off doesn't mean it turns God off.
Right.
Just because somebody rubs me the wrong way. They used to say all the time, you know, it's like a cat. Sometimes the Holy Spirit, you know, he'll he'll move, and it's like rubbing a cat's fur the wrong way. Anybody got a cat? Anybody ever had a cat? You know when you rub them backwards?
Mm-hmm.
They don't like it much.
Yeah.
And they always would say, then just turn the cat around. Because he's going to do what he does. Sometimes we need to turn the cat around in order to do what it is he's trying to get us to do.
Mm-hmm.
It may rub us the wrong way.
Right.
But it's not because it's wrong. It's because our thinking is wrong. It's because our perception of him is wrong. God is love. God brings life. And that more abundantly. And
mm-hmm.
you can write that down. That is a fact. And when troubles and problems come in your life, it is not God. It's the enemy or poor choices that we've made. But God is still on our side, even in the midst of every trial, every situation, every circumstance. Amen?
Amen.
If it's, believe me, if you're going through a bad situation, it's not God trying you. It's the devil trying to destroy you, trying to get you to take your eyes off of God or to see God in a way that is untrue. Amen?
Amen?
When God said, go to Nineveh, he wasn't punishing Jonah.
No.
He was giving Jonah a chance to be a representative of God in the earth. He was giving him an opportunity to be a reflection of God. For the Ninevites to see God. These were pagans. They had all kinds of gods, but they didn't know the God.
Right.
And the truth is, we think of, well, we live in a Christian country. Listen, there's pagans all around us. I was born.
That's right. That's right. Yeah.
You know, God, my idea of God was altogether different.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't make God different. It just meant my God was different than the God. It made me a pagan. An idolater.
Mm-hmm.
And this earth is full of them. The United States, Des Moines, Iowa.
Right.
It's filled with pagans. It's filled with idolaters. Not because they choose to be, it's because they don't know any better.
Come on.
They need a revelation. Talk about us needing revelation, and we do. But they need a revelation.
Yes.
You got to believe that there is a God. They need a revelation of God.
Yes.
They need to see something. Most people are touch me, feel me. They got to have something tangible in order to believe. Right?
Amen. Amen.
Then be that. Be that Jesus for them.
Yes.
I mean, this is a huge privilege. Think about the reward. It talks about, and I'm just rambling here, but I'm about to quit. It talks about in the end, the white throne judgment and so on and so forth. That's not us. Our judgment took place 2,000 years ago
right.
in Christ. It's already settled.
Right.
And he says, you know, people are always talking about, oh, you're going to get a great reward for that. Send some money to us and you'll get a reward in heaven. Just give me the money. I mean, if you want to just give some money, give it to me. I can make all kinds of promises too. The truth is, what reward have we got coming? What are we doing that needs to be rewarded? He has done it all.
Yes.
And that's why it says we cast our crowns back to him. Believe me, there won't be any debate in heaven about, well, I think I ought to keep mine because I really did this really big deal, you know. No, they were all his in the beginning. And anything that we do, we are to do it in Christ, right? Do it unto the Lord. So if we're doing it in Christ, unto the Lord, then he's the one that gets the reward.
Right.
He's the one that's initiating. He's the one that's functioning. It's Christ in you that's the hope of glory. It's Christ in you that's doing it.
Yes.
We just need to let him.
Yes.
We need to be God. Somebody said this a long time ago. I don't remember who. But we need to be God inside minded. We need to be aware of this Spirit of God that dwells within us, that's operating, functioning, trying to get us to cooperate with him all the time.
Yes. Amen.
I don't mean, you know, you got to worry about check off the list if you're perfect at it. I'm just saying, hey, give it a shot, man. I mean, let's try it. Let's let the Holy Spirit lead us, and not into a you know, some sort of religious act, but an act of love, an act of compassion.
Amen.
We have the capacity for this.
Amen.
He's created us this way.
Yes.
And we have the ability to do it. And I'm telling you, what we know for one thing for sure, that blind guy didn't get healed of blindness, did he? Again, please forgive me because I'm not picking on you. I'm just saying. Because you didn't stop? Well, we'll never know now, will we? Praise the Lord. That's what I'm saying.
I'm praying he shows up again.
Yeah. I hope you're not taking this the wrong way.
No, I'm not.
I mean, I've had this happen to me plenty of times in the shopping line and things, and I just, you know, you're distracted and whatever. But all I know is that if God's wanting to do something, he's still got to have a body to do it.
Right.
And that's us. And unless we are conformed to his image or transformed into the image of Christ, we're just a bunch of human beings out here waving around. And that's one of the reasons why we act so goofy sometimes. You know, acting some of the spiritual stuff that people do. It's because we want to be spiritual and don't realize how spiritual we already are. So we're trying to convince somebody else, somebody who needs prayer, that needs deliverance or whatever, that I'm spiritual enough to get this for you. So I'm going to really lay it on you thick. You know, I'm going to really get this religious thing going to where I really look like I've got some kind of power. When we don't have to do that at all.
Mm-hmm.
Look at Jesus.
Yep.
What do you want me to do? Oh, that I might be healed. Be healed. Our prayers don't have to last 20 minutes. They don't have to be loud. They don't have to be weird. We say what in agreement with what the word is, and it's done.
Amen.
It's not, I mean, I know sometimes you see that I come and I'll pray for somebody and I'll walk away and you think, boy, I guess he doesn't really care much about whether they get healed or not. That's not true. It's just that I can stand there for 20 minutes and say all kinds of stuff. But the one thing that needs to be said, once it's said, you don't need to say anything else. We do it because we feel like it helps the person who's being prayed for that they think we're really sincere.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that we're really mean that we want them. Of course we want them healed.
Right.
But we've got to just, all you have to do is say, be healed in the name of Jesus.
Right.
Thank you, Father, for healing them.
Yes.
Thank
yes.
you, Lord, for what you've done. Thank you for the finished work of the cross. And because of that, we believe that they're healed. It's that simple. And it's one thing for us as Christians to kind of go on sometimes and do some of the things that we do. But man, if unbelievers walk in here, it just freaks them out. They don't know what's going on.
Right. Right.
They need reality.
Right.
And the reality is God wants to give them life and that more abundantly.
Amen.
He doesn't want to freak them out. He doesn't want to make them uncomfortable and odd and feel odd. He wants them to feel at home, at peace, accepted.
Amen.
That's the challenge.
Yes.
I'm not saying we don't get excited, that we don't, you know, respond. I'm just saying we need to start thinking in agreement with God's higher ways. Loving.
Amen.
Compassion. To the point. You know?
Yep.
What would you have me do? He asked the guy. And he that my hand would be healed. He said, it's healed. I mean, look, really, except for the one time that the disciples said, show us how to pray, and he gives them this, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. You know, I mean, it's not like we're supposed to just repeat that rote like a Catholic prayer. It's supposed to be a format, a way of praying. So he says, amen. I hear people amen all the time.
Mm-hmm.
But I know that they don't necessarily agree with me because they later will argue about it. When we say amen, what we're saying is, it's done. It's done. So we say, be healed in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father, for healing them. Amen. We're we're saying, I agree. We accept what you said, Lord, and it's done now.
Hallelujah.
It gets to be just a thing that we say without knowing why we're saying it and what impact it has or what effect it has. And so I'm just saying we need to see God clearly and simply and then act from that reality in agreement with his word. And I'm telling you, it'll happen.
Amen.
Miracles will happen. People will be delivered. People will be set free. People will be healed. Peace, the peace of God will come that passes understanding. I mean, he's talking about this couple with the daughter that passed away. Because I haven't experienced it, and God help me, I don't ever want to. I can't imagine what they must go through. What it would be every day to live without that child. God knows.
Yes.
And he wants to bring them peace. He wants to give them comfort. He wants them to know this is not all there is.
That's right.
It's not over.
It's not over.
As believers, we're eternal beings. They'll be reunited. They'll be together again. But we're only here for one shot.
Right.
And we need to give it the best shot.
Amen.
And that's be legitimate.
Amen.
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 Praise the Lord. Thank you for your patience. Let's just be who we are, huh? Let's be our weird selves and present Jesus to weird people that need him. Amen?
Amen.
Give them life and that more abundantly.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.
What's up, man?